Attack is not stable. Так, всем привет. Слышно?
Let's see. Hello.
Dan, can you hear me?
Perfect.
Okay, very good.
I just, you look in my background, you see all my Caspian hats.
Yeah, I see. It's a collection.
So, I got myself in the mood. Even in New York, we celebrate the Caspian, just so you know.
Oh, 1 second, let me remove this stuff.
No. I see Askar Mirsaidov is on now, I think, yes.
Yeah, he's connecting.
Got it.
Hello, Askar?
Okay, perfect.
А надо же выбрать сессию сначала. Вы как спикер можете только в эту сессию войти. Нужно выбрать.
Желтым отмечено.
Нет, нет. А нужно, значит, вернуться снова зайти, зайти в мероприятие, там выбрать сессию Caspian, вот эту Caspian сессию. Да, и в ней там будет войти как спикер у вас появится кнопочка. А у меня есть. Сейчас секундочку, я с вами поговорю. Сейчас должно быть странно. Одну секундочку, сейчас. Да-да.
Мэтчу так и не может? Then you will have around 4 minutes.
That's fine.
Yeah, I think, no, 4 or 5, yeah.
You know, I feel free to cut me when you need to. I'm no problem with that.
Yeah, yeah, but I will try to do it very, very softly.
No problem. Yes. Okay.
Yeah, I will introduce you like a former advisor to the government of Kyrgyzstan, and also you have.
I wasn't exactly advisor. What you can say is that I worked in Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan.
Okay.
And I'm moving to Uzbekistan as the pandemic doesn't hit. We're going to have some very big news from Uzbekistan. I can't say just yet.
Okay.
We may even have a new agency. We actually, to be frank, we wrote the plan for the Ministry of what became Ministry of Innovation in Uzbekistan.
Okay.
But we have a plan for a different agency, and it's just being presented this week or next week. But even if that doesn't happen, we have other projects in Uzbekistan. So.
Okay. Then I will introduce that you are living in New York, United right. States, but you know perfectly Russian language, and you lived and worked in Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan, and now right. planning to go to Uzbekistan. That's why. It will be like a view from the outside, from the big wall to the Greater Caspian Region. Yes.
Perfect. And okay. and just so you know, so if things go according to plan in Uzbekistan, I think they'll. My interlocutor there already had talked with Frank a few months ago, so I think you know I'll introduce him to you too because I think there'll be good, you know, for really good collaboration there. So, you know, I'll probably be in touch with you in the next few months, I hope.
Okay. Subject to coronavirus.
Yeah, I probably would have already been in Uzbekistan by now, 6 months already, if it weren't for the virus.
Okay. And then also I will ask you to highlight what was before in the region, what is happening now, and what will be in the future. just to be ready. Yeah,
it's fine. I got it. Don't worry.
And then at the end of the speeches, we'll have questions and answers. I will give you just not only to you, to all speakers, the one big question is, what are your ideas how to unite Greater Caspian region, improve and develop interconnections with the big world? Roles of the governments, international organizations, regional organizations, and people, companies, businesses, and the role of discussion forums and think tanks like World Economic Forum, Horasis, and so on. You can pick just the part of this question and answer, because all speakers will answer. Unfortunately, we have limited time. That's why we cannot go for 20 questions. It will be just one big, and then we will see.
No problem.
Okay, perfect, perfect. Okay.
No, it's nerve-wracking for you as the organizer to make sure everybody's on.
Some technical issues. Other speakers cannot join, but okay, yes.
That's why you know it's going to happen, you know.
Okay, while our speakers, they have some technical difficulties to connect, I think we can start, because we have already some people in the audience. Okay, let's give one more minute for other speakers to join the session. Looks like slowly all issues are being resolved, and then we will start.
Hello.
Hello.
Good morning.
Good morning.
at last, I'm here.
Yes, and we are still missing the speakers.
All right.
I think let's start because otherwise we'll have no time to discuss everything. Yes, dear ladies and gentlemen, dear delegates, dear Dr. Frank Richter, chairman of Horasis, we are starting our session dedicated for the Greater Caspian region. And first of all, I would like to clarify what does it mean, Greater Caspian region, in our view. There are several names or terms which are described in this region. We prefer to use Greater Caspian region because somebody calling this region Eurasia, we think it's a bit confusing because Eurasia in our world mentality, it's Europe and Asia, the supercontinent. And some people, they think that Eurasia is something between Europe and Asia. And that's why some years ago we invented the name Greater Caspian region. And this region includes countries surrounding Caspian Sea and Black Seas, also Central Asia, also Afghanistan, north of Pakistan. If we are going to the west, starting from Bulgaria, Romania, if we'll go to the east, it's Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan. On the south is Turkey, Iran, Afghanistan. On the north is Russia, Ukraine, and Kazakhstan again. Kazakhstan is a big country. We have a region is very big. There's 500 million people living there, 5 million square kilometers. The most important thing that this region is very rich in natural resources. We can start from oil and gas, but also go into the metals and a lot of other things. But also, this region is a future potential point of growth for the world economy. And only few such places and such points of growth still remained undiscovered properly. That's why this region having great potential. And we are happy to discuss about the region. We are happy to do our efforts to try to promote and develop this region. And that's why for today, we invited speakers who are representing the region and who are from the region. And Mr. Askar Mirsaidov, he is a representative of Uzbekistan to WTO. Myself, although I'm living in Switzerland for more than 12 years, but I'm originally from Turkmenistan, which is the located on the east side of the Caspian Sea. Also, we invited Vladimir Kotenev, who is ex-ambassador of Russian Federation to Germany, and Russia also, at least south of Russia, or Caspian part of Russia, an integral part of the Greater Caspian region. He will join us later, in maybe 10-15 minutes, because other now session. And also we invited people who are very experienced in the region, or live there, or worked there, or been connected with the region for a long time. And I would like also to announce that we'll have Ambassador Matthew Bryza, who is a former U.S. ambassador to Azerbaijan and former assistant deputy secretary of state. And he was responsible for energy policy for effectively Greater Caspian region. It's officially written Europe, Eurasia, and Caucasus, but I'm calling it Greater Caspian region again. Then we have Babar Badat, immediate past president of FIATA, this international association of the freight forwarding associations. It's 10 million people working in the companies who are the members of FIATA in 160 countries. And there are 40,000 members in FIATA. And Babar Badat, he has, I think he's the best specialist in logistics in this world because he overviewed the whole logistics business for many years as the position of the president of FIATA. And also we invited Daniel Zaretsky as a co-founder of World Influencers Network. Although he is living in New York in the United States, but he perfectly can speak Russian. And he lived for a lot of time in Kyrgyzstan, in Tajikistan, and now he is moving to Uzbekistan. That's why he is really connected, and he will tell us about his experience with the Greater Caspian region. Okay, this regarding myself, I am Murat Sietnipesov. I am the president of the Greater Caspian Association in Geneva, also chairman of the organizing committee of the Caspian Week Forum in Davos, which we are doing every year in January. Unfortunately, in 2021, it will be canceled because of the coronavirus situation, but then we're hoping that this will be resolved, we will continue. And also we have other events in the different countries. And also we have strategic cooperation with Horasis, and we are inside Horasis community, we are trying to highlight Greater Caspian region. Okay, now I would like to give a floor, to start giving the floor to our speakers. I would like to invite Mr. Askar Mirsaidov, representative of Uzbekistan. From my side, Matthew, good
morning. How are you?
Very good.
I had to sign out and sign back in. Yeah, sorry.
You are not the only one. We still have
people
signing in, signing out. Yeah. Okay. I just introduced speakers. That's why you already been was introduced. Now I'm giving the floor to Askar Mirsaidov. He's a representative of Uzbekistan to WTO. And from my side, what I would like to add that all of us, we see how reforms are going on in Uzbekistan. And for us, it is a great example when during the really short time, country should be changed, could be changed so significantly. And I am a quite regular visitor to Uzbekistan for various meetings, also on the government level. And every 6 months, I see there is a significant difference. That's why I will be very happy to give the floor to Mr. Mirsaidov, who will tell us about the reforms. Also, I know that President of Uzbekistan, Mr. Mirziyoyev, recently did a great speech on the General Assembly of United Nations. We see that international experience being implemented and being used in Uzbekistan reforms. Please.
Yeah. Good morning, dear Mr. Sietnipesov, Excellency, and ladies and gentlemen. First of all, allow me to express my gratitude to the Horasis and organizers of this event for inviting me and to take part in this very important, in my opinion, talk dedicated to the Great Caspian region. Even though Uzbekistan is not part of the Caspian region, as was indicated by the moderator and number of speakers, my country plays an important role in the region, which is located in the center of the Silk Road. So since 2017, under the leadership of the President of the Republic of Uzbekistan, His Excellency Mr. Shavkat Mirziyoyev, large-scale structural transformation has been carried out in our country, aimed at building an open state with a market economy. So government officials of all levels focus on their work in ensuring the vital interests of each and every person. So the main credo of modern Uzbekistan, you can say that human interests are above all. And in order to radically increase the effectiveness of reforms and create conditions for ensuring the competitiveness, accelerate development of in all spheres of life, under the initiative of our president, Uzbekistan's development strategy for 2017-2021 has been developed. Over the last years, the specific and targeted comprehensive measures have been taken to implement the goals of the strategy. Firstly, a liberalization of the foreign exchange market made it possible to ensure free conversion of the national currency, removal of all restrictions on the repatriation of profits. Secondly, unified law on investment activities has been adopted, which guarantees the protection of private investment, legality, transparency and openness, justice, equality and non-discrimination in relation to entrepreneurship are basic principles of this law. And thirdly, the tax system developing gradually. Main goal of this system, new system which was put in place since January this year, is to create the most effective and attractive system which would stimulate the transparent conduct of business. Fourthly, work on drastic reduction of state participation in the economy has been continuing. As part of this process, the government's shares in large companies and banks of the country are put up for sale. Main goal is to create a market economy which will be built on the principles of free and dynamically developing private entrepreneurship. Fifthly, over the past 3 years, more than 45 legal acts have been adopted, trade facilitation, introducing advanced methods of custom administration and protecting intellectual property rights. In a very short period of time, Uzbekistan has jumped from 166th to 69th place in the global doing business ranking, and from 114th place to 114th place from the 152 in the Index Economic of Freedom. As a result of ongoing reforms, the role of private capital in the economy has increased significantly. The number of enterprises with foreign capital has doubled and nowadays exceeds more than 11,000. It needs to be mentioned that strategy also envisages implementation of target measures to liberalize the foreign trade regime, currency regulation, customs and tax regulation, which creates the most favorable condition for Uzbekistan's accession to WTO. In this regard, I'd like to note that our country, after 15 years of dormancy, on 7th July 2020, held the fourth working party meeting on accession to the WTO in a hybrid format, which is connected from Tashkent, and experts in member states were also joined in Geneva. And I would like to note that for Uzbekistan, WTO accession is an absolute priority. We consider this process as an integral part of ongoing reforms aimed at further integration of Uzbekistan into the world economic community and the multilateral trading system. In turn, we are also committed to continuing measures aimed at liberalizing trade, modernizing all trade political instruments based on the principles and rules of WTO, encourage foreign investments, and introduce international best practices. It is worth to note that our accession to the WTO also aims to solve strategic tasks such as ensuring the well-being of the population, as well as poverty reduction by creating new jobs. And I think these goals are fully consistent with the general agreements of on the tariffs and trade and Marrakesh agreement on establishing WTO. So we built on the belief that liberalization of access of the market economy and services should not have negative impact in sectors of the economy. And also, I would like to note that speaking at the ceremony marking the 29th anniversary in Uzbekistan independence last August, a president noted that Uzbekistan is on the threshold of a new era, the Third Renaissance. Also, as was indicated by Murad, during the 75th UN General Assembly session, the president and his address delivered a number of initiatives. I want to give some of the details, some of them which are related to economic development, namely declaration of the RLC region as a zone of environmental innovations and technologies, the importance of protecting and restoring ecological system. As you know, under this initiative, this initiative has been previously mentioned in the 72nd General Assembly meeting. In implementation of the initiative, the UN Multi-Partner Human Security Trust Fund for RLC has been created under the aegis of the UN, which I think serves as unique unified platform for international development cooperation and modernization and mobilization of donor resources to implement integrated measures. And second important initiative was establishment under the auspice of the United Nations of the Regional Center for Development on Transport and Connectivity. As you know, the Uzbekistan is in the center of Silk Road and transport issues and connectivity is vital to our country, because our country is a double landlocked country, and I think in the whole world only two countries have such status. So one of them is Uzbekistan. So for us, important is access to the sea and also transportation of our goods to our to the world market. So with this, I would like to close. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you, Mr. Mirsaidov. We got the extensive information about the reforms in Uzbekistan. Also, I would like to comment that Uzbekistan is the integral part of the Greater Caspian Region. Because Uzbekistan is not located exactly on the Caspian Sea, but it's really in the Greater Caspian Region.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Now I would like to give a floor to Daniel Zaretsky. He, as I told already, he was living for a long time in Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan, and now he is planning to move to Uzbekistan whenever the coronavirus situation will be improved. And but he is living in the United States, and I would like that he will tell us what he saw in the Greater Caspian region before, what he can see now, and what he can predict for the future of the region. Please, Daniel.
Thank you very much, Marat. And I just show you, while I'm hanging out at home in New York, you can see my collection of hats from various countries in the Greater Caspian region. And so I get everybody in the mood here. Thank you. And I just want to apologize. When you were making the introduction, I lost you for 5 minutes. I lost everybody, but I re-signed in. So for the last 5 minutes, I've seen everything. What I can talk about, I first visited the Soviet Union in 1990 and first went to work in Kyrgyzstan in 1994. So we've seen a lot of changes there. And I just will say, I'm sorry if I'm repeating what some people said, but the Greater Caspian, region, the population is over 100 million. One of the things, it's one of the few places in the world right now where the population is young. So there's demographic dividends that are very possible if used correctly. Relatively good education levels too for what their income and development levels are. And I'll talk about, what I've seen, what's changed, and what are the opportunities and how Central Asia can benefit. And one of the things that I've really seen is much greater regional cooperation and connectivity, particularly in the last, say, 5 years or so, particularly since the new president of Uzbekistan took over, which is, I would say, 4 years ago, actually. Lots of things for positive have changed. I mean, I can tell you, Tajikistan and Uzbekistan border each other. For 25 years, we had no flights. And you had to get visas if you were a Tajik or an Uzbek to visit. And I can remember we would come from Dushanbe, we would drive up to Khojand, which is the second largest city in Tajikistan in the north. Then we'd have to drive to the border, then go across the border, then get another car and drive to Tashkent and all that. Now you get on a plane, 45 minutes from Dushanbe to Tashkent. As soon as they start serving the tea, the stewardesses and the stewards, they gotta basically collect it back. So it makes it much easier. The travel for everyone is much easier. Visas in Kyrgyzstan and Kazakhstan from many countries, including Western countries, have waived visas for a certain number of days. And Uzbekistan and Tajikistan have made them much easier to get. And so on. So I think there's a lot of that. I think there's also a young generation now, as you can see from Mr. Mirsaidov here. This is the first generation, the sort of what I call post-Soviet generation, that really is engaging with the world and understands global norms and standards of behavior and international business. And it's possible to work with these people. And they understand English as well. So this is not something that you would have seen, and this is happening in all countries in the region back then. So if you'll just allow me as well, I'll just talk about some things where I see that the Central Asian countries can further unite and move forward. One of the things that I think is very interesting is city clusters across national borders. And I have a list of these here, but I think there's a very interesting project right now. You have the Fergana Valley, which is basically connecting, it includes parts of Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan, and Tajikistan, and by extension, possibly some parts of southern Kazakhstan. And this region was cut off from each other, due to the easing of trade now in the last few years, the easing of visas and transborder contacts, there's a lot of connections. And there's a plan for Tashkent, which is the capital of Kazakhstan, which a lot of people don't know, by the way, is the fourth largest city by population in the former Soviet Union. Shymkent, which is about 100 so miles away, which is the third largest city in Kazakhstan. And Khojand, which is another 100 or so miles away in Tajikistan, is the second largest city in Tajikistan. And they're an international project now to I think especially to improve the railroad between Shymkent and Tashkent and to make sort of a corridor of these three cities. So I think this is something that can really be very useful. I won't go into the rest of the clusters I wrote here, but I'll talk about water. Some of these countries like Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan are very rich in water resources. And we have the CASA 1000 project, CASA, which is there to produce electricity, which can then be sold to neighboring countries, including to Afghanistan, possibly to Pakistan and Tajikistan. I won't go into pipelines too much here. I've kind of gone, I'll just give a few quick, maybe one or two more minutes points about the borders and the visas I've talked about. One of the things is tourism. One of the things you see is that I'm the co-CEO of the World Influencers Network. And in August 2019, we had the World Influencers Congress, 100 influencers from 40 countries came to Uzbekistan to promote tourism, shoot content, and so on. And this got over 100 million media views around the world and so on. I think that having this joint Silk Road tourism visa that they're talking about between the countries, I know it's at least Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, Kyrgyzstan, and Kazakhstan right now. I think this will be very helpful to make it easier to bring tourists to the region. I think that's something they can look at. I think logistics centers and feeder routes, and I think I've kind of sort of hinted at that with the city cluster. One of the things that two last points then, in terms of uniting the Russian is still a very important language in the region. I see it remaining that way for at least 20 or 30 more years. It's not just that people still send their people to study in Russia, their kids and so on, but it's also that a lot of the good schools are in the Russian language in the region. English is increasing, but you will find a lot of times when people from different countries in the region or different countries of the former Soviet Union approach each other, they'll still talk in Russian. So that's still a uniter. And a lot of the national heroes are actually shared among the different countries. One last thing that I'll talk about for the future that I see, I was involved in Amsterdam and Tajikistan, and I think getting chambers of commerce together with American chambers of commerce, other chambers of commerce, and having regional events promoting the region as a whole, because we say the region as a whole is 100 million people. And another thing that I see here is regional investment funds are coming in, outside regional investment funds are coming in. And the last point I'll just make very quickly on this is we know Russia has sort of the EEAU, I believe it's the Eurasian Economic Union. Correct me if I'm wrong. And China has the One Belt, One Road Initiative. And something I'm very interested in is this new American initiative with Australia and Japan, which is the Blue Dot Initiative, as well, about investing in the region in projects. I don't know if call it a competitor of the One Belt, One Road, but it's a not a competitor. What's the opposite word of competitor? Friendly, a friendly thing. So this is something that I think to start to look at this, and I'll be very interested to see how that comes into play. And one last point here is I think that these countries all together can have greater influence among the wider world by cooperating, because by each they're small, but if they can get together, maybe work on some issues that they want, which they're doing. I also want to also talk about the Caspian Sea initiatives. I think these are things. So just to conclude, I see a lot of positives in the region. I see a lot of positive change. I'm very excited about the young generation. Really, I'm excited. They've been waiting for this. And I think that it's a place to look at in the future. And I'll turn it back to Murat. Thank you very much. I hope I kept in my time and so on.
Not at all, but yeah, thank you very much for extensive information. Because a really big overview, and I think it will be very useful for our audience to understand more our region. Now we started to be running short of time. That's why I will give now the floor to Mr. Asif Iqbal. He's the general director of the Indian Economic Trade Organization in India. And I will ask him to talk about the cooperation between India and the Greater Caspian region. I will not give too many information about India. Everybody knows India. Just I would like to tell this. It's almost first biggest population in the world. I think in 5 years we will see this. And this is the future superpower. Okay, Mr. Iqbal, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Murat, and thanks all the gentlemen. As we talk about the region, Caspian region, we are today I'm trying to talk about the new great powers and the link between the Caspian region. So all the while we have been having only these countries, you know, which is dividing Europe from Asia and the Caucasus region. The region has been controlled traditionally by the Middle East, and it has been a historic zone of contention between powers like Greece and Persians, Chinese and Arabs, Russian and Turks, and of course, and all of the above now, the modern Iran. So what we are seeing now is it is more prominent because with the end of Soviet Union, this world's oil industry has emerged as an important zone of exploitation by international oil companies, and which is also now the source of energy for this world. Everybody is involved here. Americans, Iranians, Turkish, Chinese oil companies, Iraq and Russians. They are all the participants in this claims to the Caspian. Now, the point is, how do we get the oil out is the question here. And many people believe, contrary to the US policy, that the most direct and the cheapest route would be through Iran. And various strategies India is working out since the oil prices were not high as they are now. Now, how are the rapid development and settlement of disputes over dividing the Caspian Sea? The hopes are going to be realized, I hope, now. And also, I want to talk about how India and US are discussing about the interest in the Caspian region, where India is now directed by a lot of US policies. And the Caspian matters as energy security because we are working with the United States to develop positive investment climate in the Caspian region and also to debunk all the myths about the policies in relation to Russia and Iran, because we have very good relations with all of them and we have to balance it in a very, very moderate and, in a very balanced way, basically. So therefore, to create a positive investment climate for US and other countries is very important. I want to update you and highlight, especially to Murat, about a meeting that we had 2 weeks ago in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs to have the India Caspian Sea Region, Chamber of Trade Council, which India would work only with those countries which are around that place to specifically address and focus with the embassies, the Indian embassies, to talk about the energy requirements and the energy strategies. So now the Caspian region is really important. And the region's energy potential markets are important player for international dialogue for India's participation on energy security. And what is important for us is the diversity of supply, transportation, and how the oil is being developed and used. India has tied up with Aramco in the recent years. And now we are also going to be trying to work with various other new countries. And our Eurasian positioning is also very strong now. And one of the important Indian goals is the Indian energy security, which will be very significantly advanced because the region is becoming a reliable supplier of oil and gas to the Western markets. Diversity of supply is important to India. And it's not that we want to have over-reliance on one region as a supplier, but India thinks it's better to have more rather than, you know, few choker points. So especially the non-OPEC oil production over the long run will be important for our security, and it will be help to stabilize the oil market, reduce the prices. And we are looking forward to make a much stronger, collaboration with the Caspian Sea region with all these five countries that are already here. And we look forward to see how we can work on these collaborations and make them much more stronger in a much more structured fashion and an organized fashion.
Thank you, Mr. Iqbal. Thank you for this optimistic speech. For us, India, for the Greater Caspian region, not only for the five Caspian Sea countries, but for the Greater Caspian region, India is a strategic partner because a lot of there is a big cargo flow between the Greater Caspian region and India. Also, there are projects which could be developed, and not only oil side, but there is a one unique project called Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India natural gas pipeline, which can bring, I will not tell clean, but cleaner energy to India. Because I was in India, I know the ecological situation in India. I know that still India is using coal and other things to produce energy. And of course, oil is better than coal, but natural gas is at least twice better than oil from ecology side. And also, it can bring the diversity of the energy supplies to India. And this we can discuss also during today's session. We got news from Frank. Our time is a little bit extended. That's why I will not push speakers too much. And now I would like to introduce Mr. Babar Badat, who is the immediate past president of FIATA. I already told that what it is FIATA. It's federation of the trade union associations and the 40,000 members, 10 million employees. And I would like Badat to tell us about the transport corridors connecting Great Caspian region and the big world, also international cooperation and the infrastructure projects which could be developed, implemented to connect our region to the world. As we could see from the previous speeches, the logistics and connectivity is very important. No matter it's for cargoes, it's for people, like then told about the tourism, but this is very important. And please, Mr. Badat.
Okay, Murad. Good morning, good afternoon, everybody. It's good to be back on the screen. Matthew, I see you there, looking a bit older than the last time we met. And Murad, thank you. Thank you for putting this together. I'm sorry it took me a few minutes getting on online over here because we had a problem with our connectivity over here. Must have been a bad day. I think there's some problem. So I hope I'm trying to get on as clearly as I possibly can. The Caspian region, most exciting region, very dynamic, always causes the tension, at least for me, and the logistics industry. It's huge, it's landlocked, and always represents challenges for us. As a logistics person and having been ahead of FIATA, we have always focused on trying to see that we can facilitate landlocked areas for access to the oceans. And of course, nothing represents Caspian better than this. We've always been concerned about that. There has been energy over there. There is people over there, and we need to connect it with the world. Week before last, we had a powerful delegation from Uzbekistan and Islamabad. And they were talking about connectivity and in the region. there was a discussion about using the Pakistani ports for taking goods out, in and out traffic, use the TIR to move goods, things over there. Of course, Iran is a real possibility also, but it's under the cloud of sanctions today, so that has a political ramification. But political ramification, the side speaking from purely the business point of view or a logistics point of view, the Iranian ports are there, of course, whenever they are out of this mess that they are in. But for the time being, it's Pakistani ports which provide this opportunity. There are other projects like the TAPI, which Murad, you just mentioned. That's the Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and India project, which is very fundamental. There are a couple of other smaller projects, again, to move energy within the region. Of course, then you've got the East-West thing over there. So there is a lot of area, a lot of activity which is going on in the area. And I think moving forward, we have to create an enabling environment for the private sector, the logistics industry to perform. There has been a very strong initiative at the highest levels of Turkmenistan government in trying to connect and upgrade their industry. They have already reached out to FIATA, and their national association is going to become a member over there. They're going to go in for courses, training over there in Turkmenistan. Uzbekistan is already there. They've upgraded their connection with FIATA, and so are the other countries over there. To have a well-structured connectivity, seamless connectivity with a well-structured industry, logistics industry connecting over the region. And that's imperative. In Pakistan, we've got three main ports, Karachi, Qasim, and Gwadar. Gwadar is being for countries of Central Asia, Caspian region, connect the newer areas.
Okay.
Population on the south.
Okay, looks like we started to have problems with connection on your side. Just we lost you for the last 30 seconds. Так. Okay. Looks like there is a problem with internet in Pakistan. Okay, you cannot see Mr. Badat anymore on the screen, yeah? Okay, then let him connect back, then I will ask him to continue. Now, let's move a little bit further because we still have time limitation. Now I would like to invite Matthew Bryza, former United States Ambassador to Azerbaijan, former Director for Europe and Eurasia of National Security Council of United States, former Deputy Assistant of Secretary of State for Europe and Eurasia, coordinating energy policy for the Greater Caspian Region. Matthew, am I right?
You're right. You have good sources of information, Murat.
Yeah, now we have Wikipedia.
Very good about me.
And 2 years ago, we had a really significant development in the economy of the region and also in the political situation in the region. The legal status convention of the Caspian Sea was signed. It was 12th of August 2018. And Matthew is a great specialist and expert in the Caspian Sea energy policy. That's why I would like to ask him to tell us a little bit about this convention and the potential projects which can be materialized after this convention was signed. And also another hot topic, perspectives of the Trans-Caspian gas pipeline, which can connect eastern side of the countries on the east side of the Caspian Sea to Europe. and also security of the transit corridors of the Greater Caspian region. Please, Matthew.
Okay, thanks, Murat. And I'm so happy to be back with you because our time at Caspian Week in Davos was sort of the last moment of normal life, at least for me, when we were still coming together. So I feel like somehow I'm back to normal, even as I sit at home. Yeah, those are a lot of topics, so I'll move quickly. I'll try not to speak so fast, but I'll be really concise. They're all interrelated topics, of course, because for years, going back to 1998 is when I started working toward a Trans-Caspian natural gas pipeline, as well as Baku-Tbilisi-Ceyhan oil pipeline. It was, of course, the demarcation of the Caspian Sea that was one of the major obstacles to a Trans-Caspian pipeline, one of. The other major obstacles were the objections of Russia and Iran to such a pipeline on environmental grounds, usually, right? That there could be a natural gas leak or construction could endanger the Caspian seal or could potentially harm sturgeon even more. So the convention from August of 2018 helps in terms of resolving some of the demarcation questions, but doesn't do anything with regard to the environmental obstacles or objections. Well, what do I mean? Throughout those years, 98 until, for me, 2018, so 20 years, it was possible for Iran and Russia to take advantage of the ambiguity of Caspian boundaries. And since it hadn't been decided whether, you know, we're going to treat the Caspian as a sea or a lake, some could argue, Iran could argue, well, the entire sea is common to everybody, the water, the subsea area, and Russia would sometimes argue that. And so then they could say, and therefore, Turkmenistan and Azerbaijan cannot build a pipeline across their territory without our approval. That obstacle is gone. The 2018 August Convention removes that obstacle because it says that as long as a country on one side and a country on the other side of the Caspian agree that they want to build, whether it be a fiber optic cable or a pipeline, that's their business. Nobody else can interfere. So that clears out a major obstacle. But there's still a lot of uncertainty. Countries can still object to a pipeline or a cable on environmental grounds. And that is what has been happening. Moscow and Tehran have been doing that, not as vociferously as in the past, and still now in a much better spirit that the convention creates of everybody trying to work together. But there's still some work to be done. So the convention, it establishes territorial seas for all the Caspian states of 10 miles. It establishes fisheries 15 miles out from the mainland, but it doesn't yet demarcate what the actual borders are or how far your economic, essentially your exclusive economic zone can go. That's to be decided through future bilateral negotiations. So there's a lot of work still out there to resolve some of these basic questions, but the fact that all parties agree now that as long as country on one side of the Caspian agrees to the other to build some cross-Caspian infrastructure, it can proceed legally. That's good. That's a big step forward. As far as the Trans-Caspian pipeline goes, while that legalistic argument is now removed, now the key question is economic, right? I mean, how much gas demand is there going to be available in Azerbaijan, which I think the answer is a significant amount because of Azerbaijan's expanding petrochemicals industry. But then how much demand will there be down the line in Georgia, Turkey, and in the EU space? And, you know, for the last few years and into the foreseeable future, in Europe, natural gas is a buyer's market, right? I mean, prices are going to be low because of so much supply and decreased demand for quite some time. Liquid natural gas, especially U.S. LNG, from our perspective, we could say is a culprit in making Trans-Caspian gas less attractive economically. But there is a lot of political will there. And I, you know, right now, Azerbaijan is focused on something else. I've noticed in the last few years, there's been an increasing appetite in Baku to facilitate the import of Turkmenistani gas to help build Azerbaijan's petrochemicals industry. Last issue you asked about, Murat, the security of the pipeline. So Azerbaijan is at war right now. I mean, the security of the pipelines across the Caspian and, you know, on the eastern side, Turkmenistan, there's not much to worry about there. But Azerbaijan and Armenia are back at war. This isn't just armed conflict. This isn't just, you know, something that's going to settle down very quickly. These are really serious military operations. Like, I was also the mediator of the Nagorno-Karabakh conflict for 3 years. And, you know, nothing like this has happened since 1994. You know, Azerbaijan has struck the so-called capital of Nagorno-Karabakh, Stepanakert. That never happened after 94. Azerbaijan has recovered significant amounts of its own territory from Armenian occupation. That had never really happened either. And so to wrap it up, what I think is going to happen is that Azerbaijan is going to continue its counteroffensive until it has regained what it feels is a politically significant amount of its own territory. My guess would be maximally that would be two of its districts that surround Nagorno-Karabakh in the southeastern part of the region, and it's called Jabrail and Fizuli. The key question will be, can Azerbaijan hold on to that territory? With Turkey's support, it's so far political support, but also unmanned aerial vehicle support, which can be decisive. I think Azerbaijan stands a pretty good chance of hanging on to that territory. So at some point after several days, weeks, I think we'll see the fighting die down. And I think there will be serious Armenian counterattacks, however, as is happening. But I think Azerbaijan will hang on to that territory. And then I think there'll be a new map, if you will, and a new set of circumstances to return to the negotiations. Whether the OSCE's Minsk group, of which I was a co-chair, as Murat mentioned, will play the leading role remains to be seen. I think the key players are going to be Turkey and Russia. I think the U.S. has withdrawn from the region, not just under President Trump, but also under President Obama. What that all means for the security of the pipelines, I think, is not so bad, or the transit routes. I think that once those negotiations start up again, for certain, Turkey and Azerbaijan will have an interest in seeing all the flows of oil and gas, road transit, rail transit, fiber optic data continue. And I just find it hard to believe that we're going to get to a point where there actually are attacks on that infrastructure that disrupt it for a long term. Because to disrupt that stuff for a long period, you have to hold the territory. Pipelines get blown up all the time. They were getting blown up, you know, on a monthly basis in Colombia for years. And it's not very difficult to repair them. The problem is if a hostile actor seizes control of the right of way and doesn't allow the repairs to the pipelines. And I cannot see that happening. I mean, I could be wrong, but I don't think that's going to happen. And next year at this time, or if we're in Davos together, inshallah, in January, I hope we'll be saying, see, the pipelines were able to keep on operating. My last point, just like during the Russia-Georgia war, the Baku-Tbilisi-Ceyhan oil pipeline, the South Caucasus gas pipeline, never stopped operating throughout that brief war. And so I think we're going to see the same continuing now here in Azerbaijan's territory. Thanks.
Thank you, Matthew. At least oil export from Caspian Sea looks like is safe and could go and continue going. Thank you. Now I would like to ask again Mr. Babar Badat to continue his speech, because it was interrupted due to the technical problems, and luckily now it will be fine.
Yes, Murad, I don't know where I got cut off, but basically what I was trying to say was that there's a lot of effort going on in trying to connect this Caspian region with the southern ports, and with the huge mass of population that we have got in South Asia, which is Pakistan, India, Bangladesh, and Sri Lanka, and we are all energy deficient. So the energy resources in the Caspian region need to connect this way. And to do that, we have to have logistics connectivity. And I think there is a lot of effort in some of the countries where at the highest level of government, they are pushing for this. Turkmenistan, of course, is one example where they're trying to connect this way. And then you've got, as I said, a high-level delegation from Uzbekistan, which was in Pakistan and Islamabad 2 weeks ago. And they're trying to make a connect in this region. We have the issues in Afghanistan, which seem to be resolving. And I think overland transportation between the regions would start more vibrantly in the coming months. Hopefully, that's what we're hoping. the essential thing, of course,